This video is brought to you by Brilliant. Ever since China's rapid urbanization and property boom began in the 90s, local governments in China have been using their land as collateral to borrow enormous sums of money, often via opaque shell companies known as LGFVs. Unfortunately for Beijing, a combination of factors, including falling land prices, weaker tax revenues, and higher interest rates, have put local government finance under serious strain. But new data obtained by the Financial Times suggests the crisis is significantly worse than most serious analysts imagined, with certain provincial governments struggling with debt burdens representing over 100% of regional GDP, and others spending literally all their tax revenues just on paying off the interest. So in this video, we're going to take another look at China's long-standing local government debt crisis, why it's got so much worse, and why, while we shouldn't expect a full-on collapse anytime soon, this could be terrible news for China's GDP figures. Before we start, if you haven't already, please consider subscribing and ringing the bell to stay in the loop and be notified when we release new videos. Now, the first thing to say is that we've already done specific videos on not just China's local government debt crisis, but also the issues with China's GDP statistics and China's over-reliance on investments, which are both very relevant to this video. So go and watch those if you want to know more. Anyway, let's start with a quick primer on how GDP works in China. In most of the world, GDP growth is measured as an output by statistical authorities at the end of the year. In China, though, instead of just measuring it at the end of the year, the central government actively sets GDP targets for regional governments at the beginning of the year. In other words, GDP isn't just an output, but it's also an input. Anyway, usually the CCP sets pretty high targets, around 5% these days, both to keep unemployment low and impress international markets. This makes life pretty tough for local governments, because even though they've been responsible for funding their own public services and meeting Beijing's growth targets since 1994, most taxes go straight to Beijing. On top of that, Beijing also has laws limiting how much money they can borrow. So if local governments aren't allowed to borrow money or keep their own taxes, how do they meet these growth targets? Well, what usually happens is that local governments use shell companies, known as local government financing vehicles, or LGFVs. Local governments give these LGFVs land for free, and then the LGFVs either sell the land to developers or, more often, use the land as collateral to borrow money. These LGFVs then invest this money into expensive infrastructure projects, because this counts as investment and therefore counts towards GDP. However, not all infrastructure projects are actually good investments. This might sound a bit weird if you're from the West, because, well, basically every Western country is desperately in need of better infrastructure. But China has almost the opposite problem, in that its infrastructure is almost too good, at least relative to the demands of its relatively poor population, which means that new infrastructure projects are basically unnecessary. In economic lingo, these investments don't sufficiently increase productivity to justify their costs, which means that local governments, or their respective LGFVs, have to take on more and more debt to meet their GDP targets. A perfect example of this is Guizhou, one of the poorest provinces in China, with a mostly agricultural economy and a GDP per capita of less than $7,000. Guizhou's GDP has grown rapidly over recent years, but this growth has been unbalanced, insofar as it's mainly been driven by infrastructure investment, without a corresponding increase in consumer demand. In the last 15 years or so, Guizhou's local government has built over 1,000 new bridges, including some of the highest bridges in the world, including at least one costing over ₩1 trillion. But this is just too many bridges, especially given that Guizhou's population is actually pretty poor and mostly agricultural. Unsurprisingly then, these bridges haven't really increased either productivity or tax revenues, which is why, earlier this year, Guizhou's central government asked for a bailout from Beijing. Anyway, because local governments borrow so much of their funding via LGFVs, measuring the actual debt burden has always been difficult. But even in the 2010s, China watchers were warning that they were getting uncomfortably high. Unfortunately, three things have conspired to make things worse for local governments recently. First, the property crisis, which has significantly reduced demand for land in China, which in turn means local governments can't borrow anywhere near as much by using land as collateral. Second, the slowdown in consumer activity, as evidenced by China's deflation numbers, because less economic activity means fewer taxes. And third, higher interest rates. Rising interest rates in the rest of the world clearly feeds through to China's shadow banking sector, which is both why China's economy went into crisis mode after the Fed hiked rates in 2015, and why the crisis has got worse despite successive rate cuts by China's central bank. And, well, the crisis has indeed got a lot worse. According to documents obtained by the Financial Times, 10 of China's 33 provinces now have debt burdens representing over 50% of GDP, and 4, including Guizhou, have debt burdens representing over 100% of GDP. Now, this might sound absolutely insane, given that 100% of GDP would be a dangerously large debt burden for most countries, let alone a province. But it's worth keeping in mind that most of these provinces are the size of your average European country. Gansu and Chongqing, for instance, both have populations of about 30 million people, a bit smaller than Poland, but bigger than the Netherlands. Nonetheless, while their size might make an acute financial crisis unlikely, this clearly isn't sustainable, not least because just servicing this debt, i.e. paying off the interest, is now costing 8 provinces literally all of their tax revenues. And even the wealthier provinces like Shanghai and Beijing have seen their servicing costs more than double. To remedy this crisis, the CCP are basically doing two things. First, they've agreed to partial bailouts for some of the most indebted local provinces, restructuring their debt via state banks. To this end, China's central government recently announced plans to issue $140 billion of long-term bonds, one of the biggest issuances in recent times. But second, and more significantly, they've told local governments to stop investing in more infrastructure projects and cancel some early-stage ones. This is sensible, but it's also politically difficult, because this is the main way that local governments have been able to inflate their GDP figures to meet Beijing's targets. Without these infrastructure projects, it's going to be really difficult for local governments to meet their GDP targets, and it's hard to see China's GDP growth going anywhere but down in the next few years. Nonetheless, even if it puts a dent in the headline numbers, this is probably the right step for China, which probably needs to move away from investment and export-led growth towards a more balanced, consumer-driven economy. A lot of stuff that we talk about at TLDR News can seem pretty complicated, especially when we dive into economics and detailed data, which is why we use Brilliant.org to keep us sharp. Brilliant is where you learn by doing, with thousands of interactive lessons in maths, data analysis, programming, and AI. Brilliant is a learning platform designed to be uniquely effective. Their first principles approach helps you build understanding from the ground up, which is also how we structure TLDR videos. Each lesson is filled with hands-on problem solving that lets you play with concepts, a method proven to be 6 times more effective than just watching lectures. Plus, all content on Brilliant is crafted by an award-winning team of teachers, researchers, and professionals from MIT, Caltech, Duke, Microsoft, Google, and more. Brilliant helps build your critical thinking skills through problem solving, not memorizing. So, while you're building real knowledge on specific topics, you'll also be becoming a better thinker. Learning a little every day is one of the most important things you can do, both for your personal and professional growth. Brilliant helps you build real knowledge in minutes a day, with fun lessons you can do whenever you have time. It's the opposite of mindless scrolling. Brilliant recently launched a ton of new content in data, all of which uses real-world data to train you to see trends and make better informed decisions, something politicians could really learn from. Anyway, these are for learners of any level to start or continue learning data analysis, with a fully built-out suite of new content, from Bayes' theorem to multiple linear regression. And you can truly learn by doing, as you'll be working with real datasets from sources like Starbucks, Twitter, Spotify, and more. To try everything that Brilliant has to offer for free for a full 30 days, click on the link in the description. You'll also get 20% off an annual premium subscription. Thanks for watching, and thanks to Brilliant for their support of TLDR News.